We are headed toward a planet which is a network.
What does the world need? And how can microelectronics assist in that?
Technology appears faster and faster, ever more powerful.
It's very rare to go through a day without interacting with the chip.
We have to learn how to deal with technology.
You know, we create a future. We are constantly working on making things possible that are not yet state of the art.
We are now in the small shelter of our parents. It looks now like a somewhat outdated place, but this was a happy place because, yeah, here I was active making stuff.
Yeah, we made things like power supplies. I was also making radios, and there were only two transistors to make it work. And yeah, that's completely different now because transistors cost nothing. They are there with millions, even billions on a chip, and we can use them without any restriction. So the complexity of these systems get crazy.
You see these white bars at the top. You have this apartment flat, you see a few, and also there, two, three more. Also there, and two more over there. Mobile phones. Everybody has at least one. Some people have three. The mobile doesn't communicate directly to other mobiles. They connect to a big transmitter at the top of a roof. And these transmitters, these are the things we work on. People collect information and they share information. And we do that more and more and more. So wireless communication and ICT has a CO2 footprint which is comparable to global aviation. The energy consumption is still going up. And that is a trend that we really need to reverse.
We want to consume more and more nice things that make our life maybe better, but not per se society a better place.
People have about 20 devices that can do computing for them. And this number is still on the rise.
The resources that make those chips are not limited. They come at a cost of certain consumption.
Electricity and CO2, that is a price we're gonna pay altogether. You have a base station. It's designed for maximum capacity, and most of the time, it's doing far, far less. But it's still consuming a lot of power. So to make systems that only consume power when they are actually doing something useful, that should be one of the next focus points. This is the first attempt to do a digital transmitter at power levels that are useful for industry. Since it's digital, when you don't transmit, you don't consume power. So what is so special about this? Well, in general, it's going to mean that it's going to save a lot of power. With these technologies, you can maybe merge a few of them and have one single base station that does the same thing.
Every second, we are creating in the world more transistors than that there are humans on this planet. So it's mind-boggling. You can consider this as the heart of the clean room because here we define the patterns on the chip and this is where everyone has to go through. It's like a playground. Having all of these tools in one place and still have the freedom to explore new materials and new devices. That makes this facility unique. Just to put it in perspective, on a modern chip, you have 30 kilometers of wire in one square centimeter.
It almost looks magical.
If you zoom in on them, you will find them beautiful.
It's like you're entering the city from above.
It's much more complex than a real city because it has much more layers. We are talking about 12 or 14 levels of road to connect everything. The city is bursting with information. So there's a lot of things going on. There's also a lot of things that are happening that we can't perceive as a human being. think about pollution in the air. We can actually use odors to sense if a fruit is getting ripe, if chickens have a disease. I'm working on nanomaterials to enable gas sensors. So gas sensors in general can have a lot of benefits for humanity. Nature doesn't do things just for fun. There's always a reason behind that. Nature uses this, and we should try to tap into that and to try to get this information out of that. You can't do this with traditional materials. You really need to innovate to be able to realize these functionalities. I consider it my baby. In this tool, we can actually deposit the nanomaterials, which are, well, unique to my sensors, which are graphene layers of just a few atomic layers of carbon. And that makes it an ideal choice for gas sensors. These 2D materials like graphene, they have only surface, which means that anything they absorb, you're gonna sense that. Having good gas sensors, which augment our own senses, will give us a wider understanding of the world.
We don't decide what society is doing, but we can try to make what they want the most lowest CO2 profile.
If I can make more energy efficient base stations that is actually doing the same with far less energy, then I think I did quite something special. It could be maybe 1 or 2% of the global electricity usage. That could be the potential saving. But hey, we still need to get there, huh? So this is the dream.
At the university, we hope we're trying to do things for the benefit of humankind. We are really exploring the boundaries of our knowledge.
The universities are the best places when it comes to figuring out what might be useful and needed in a couple of years down the road. Companies will not do that.
Makes me feel proud to think that that's a possibility, that the stuff we're doing could change the world someday.
Microelectronics is a big product of civilization and captures a lot of who we are and who we are going to be.